to my latest movie review, where today I review the second film of the Night at the Museum trilogy, Night at the Museum 2, Battle of the Smithsonian. Once again, the film was directed by Shawn Levy, who directed the first one, and this one was released in 2009. So the basic plot of Night at the Museum 2 is as follows. Security guard Larry Daly infiltrates the Smithsonian Institution in order to rescue Jedediah and Octavius, who have been shipped to the museum by mistake. There we go, that's the basic premise of Night at the Museum 2, Battle of the Smithsonian. Right, okay. Night at the Museum 2. This is a ridiculous sequel. I really don't like this film. I think it was a real step down after the first one. That's not to say that the first one was anything amazing. It wasn't. It was good. It was a good family movie, and I really enjoyed it. But this one, I just didn't care for it. I know this is a common phrase and a common misconception about sequels, but I have to be honest. This sequel sucks the charm and the fun out of the original film. I'm sorry. In my opinion, that's what it does. For one thing, I think it's just messy. I think the structure of the film is a little all over the place. It doesn't really know what to do with its characters. It just basically tries to do the same thing as the first one. It's a rehash. Everybody's after that damn tablet again. Akhman Ra's brother, Karman Ra, wants to use it to unleash the underworld. Like, really? I mean, this is a Night at the Museum movie. It's kind of silly, really. I know this is meant to be a fun family movie, but I kind of struggle to take it seriously. There's no credibility with this plot. Again, this plot is ridiculous because Karman Ra hasn't thought about this plan because he's a museum exhibit and his army are museum exhibits. The tablet only brings things to life at night. So what do they do during the daytime? They're frozen. It's ridiculous. It's totally stupid for me. I also feel the comedy of this film really doesn't work. I mean, there were a couple of laughs, don't get me wrong, but I just found it to be very awkward, even more so than the first one. I actually thought the first one had its funnier moments, and I still think the first one is quite funny, but this one really isn't. It's just awkward. They are gearing the humour more towards a child audience, and that's fine. I don't have a problem with that, but it doesn't work. There is one particular scene where Darth Vader, like a guy dressed as Darth Vader, and there's another guy holding a Muppet in a bin, they come to be villains? Like, what? This scene comes out of nowhere. Where does this scene come from? What reference does it have to anything? It's not funny. It doesn't make me laugh. Like, what? I was scratching my head during that scene. Like, it really doesn't make sense. Like, what the hell is going on? I just think it's a mess, really. This whole film is a mess. Also, the characters from the first film really are wasted. They don't get anything to do. Characters like Teddy Roosevelt doesn't get anything to do in this film. We see a bust version of him in the Smithsonian Museum, but the real life Teddy doesn't get anything to do in this film. So they wasted Robin Williams in this film. They absolutely wasted him, which is a real shame. Some of the old museum exhibit characters get nothing to do. I'll talk about Jed and Octavius in a minute, but Sacagawea, Attila the Hun, Dexter the Monkey, Akhman Ra, I mean, they're barely in it. They don't get anything to do. They're mostly just sat inside a metal container for most of the film, which is annoying. Even some of the new characters, like General Custer, played by Bill Hader, he's wasted in this film. He doesn't get anything to do. He sits in the metal container with the others, and then at the end they go and attack everyone. Like, he doesn't do anything in the film. As for Owen Wilson and Steve Coogan, I mean, they're good as Jed and Octavius. It's nice to see them back. I mean, Owen Wilson gives a particularly energetic performance, although most of the film, he's sitting inside an hourglass. He gets nothing to do. And then Octavius goes to rescue him and rides a squirrel. Riddle me that. Why go on the squirrel? It makes literally no sense. It's just an excuse for a cheap laugh, and I'm sorry. I wasn't laughing. I also think that squirrel itself, the CGI, not good. So the three henchmen in the film, Ivan the Terrible, Napoleon, and Al Capone, they were funny, they were quite amusing for the little moments they had. But, oh my god, the villain. The villain in this film, Karman Ra, played by Hank Azaria, who is a very good actor. I could not stand this villain. Tony's character was just so annoying. Honestly, he was just really annoying. I could not stand him. Hank Azaria really tries. Hank Azaria's kind of playing him sort of very camp with a sort of English accent. And, you know, I do admire his take on the role. Like, this is this spoiled brat, basically. And they basically turn him into a joke for the entire film. He's constantly, you know, every time they build him up to be quite evil, he's like, oh, that's fantastic. Brilliant. See what I mean? It's just very camp. I just don't like him very much at all. And that scene when Larry returns with the tablet, when he's like, don't touch me, here! That just drove me nuts. Honestly, that scene just dragged on too long. It really just drove me nuts. I just couldn't stand him. He was really annoying. And I was glad when they dispatched him. He was really annoying, honestly. Again, great performance by Hank Azaria. He gives a good performance, but the character's just really badly written. I like Ben Stiller in the movie, and I think he gives a good performance once again as Larry, although I think he's better in the first movie. I was very sorry to hear about his dad, Jerry Stiller, who passed away a few days ago. Actually, nearly a week ago. I forgot to mention it in my first review, so sorry about that. One other criticism I lobby at this film is the end fight. The fight scene between Larry and Carmen Ra, is ridiculous. It's just stupid. It's meant to be staged like a sword fight, but Larry's using a torch. He's using a flashlight. What the hell? You know, he's doing all these like ninja moves and everything. Like, how can he do this? He was a flipping security guard in a museum. It's not like he was a trained assassin or something. It's just really stupid. It doesn't make any sense. I just don't know what they were trying to do here, whether they were trying to make it funny or because they're playing epic music with it, so I don't know. It's just, God, it's such a mess. And then there's that stupid, god-awful line before he throws Carmen Ra into the underworld. He says, what are you? And he goes, I'm the Night Guard. Larry, you are not a superhero. You were a security guard, and now you're a torch salesman. It's ridiculous. This script is just terrible. Actually, a point about Larry is Larry actually decided to leave his old job at the museum and go and be what he wanted to be in the first movie, like an inventor. He invented a glow-in-the-dark flashlight and now he's become famous. I really think Larry's character, the way they wrote him at the beginning of this film, it makes the first one redundant because he went through this character arc of trying to find his place and trying to stabilize his life. And, you know, he ditched the idea of, you know, the snapper and the clapper and trying to be an inventor. And then he goes back to it in this one. Like, he found his place, he found his calling, and now he just ditches it and goes to be an inventor. Like, what? And then he comes back at the end of this film to his old job. So what was the point, you know? Like, they just completely ruined his character arc in the first one. It's such a mess, honestly. I do not know what happened with this script. It is awful. The best thing I can say about this film is Amy Adams. Amy Adams as Amelia Earhart is absolutely terrific. She is wonderful in this film. She really steals the show, and her use of dialogue is really funny, and her scenes with Ben Stiller are really good. I don't really see why they added the romance in, to be honest, because then there's that scene at the end when Amy Adams appears as someone else in the museum, and then he goes off to talk to her, and we think there's going to be a romance there, but, well, we don't see her in Night at the Museum 3, so sorry. I like Alan Silvestri's music for the film, and the title sequence, in a similar way to the first one with the text and then in the museum, although this time the exhibits are being taken out because they're being shipped to the Smithsonian. So I liked the title sequence and music this time. I also find this film to be quite boring. I think the pacing of the film really just drags. It starts to become just a sequence of comedy, and it falls completely flat. There's not really much story. They have to go and find the combination to open the tablet, and the combination is pi. What? Why on earth does the tablet have a combination that is pi? I have no idea. That doesn't make any sense. You know, they have to go to the heart of the Pharaoh's tomb, and then they say, tomb, oh, it's a triangle, it's a pyramid, so the answer's pi. What? It makes no sense. Again, the comedy falls really flat, and the film drags on for, it's an hour, 1 hour, 45 minutes. It just really bored me, to be honest, it really bored me. The film is just very gimmicky as well, like, it's just showing off the Smithsonian and some of the exhibits that are in there. And, I mean, there was some nice visual imagery, like, with the paintings and stuff, but showing the little Einsteins and all the air and space stuff, it's just gimmicky. Like, I can go and to the Smithsonian, I could go and visit Washington, D.C. and see this. I don't need you to show me everything coming to life, but Yeah, that's what they do. I mean, it's a Night at the Museum movie. So, in short, I think Sean Levi's direction for this film is awful. Really awful. I don't know what he was on making this film, but it doesn't work for me. It's probably the weakest of the trilogy for me. I just got really bored watching this, and there isn't much charm to it. There isn't much heart. There's no great character development. The comedy's awful. The villain sucks. It's just ridiculous. It gets really silly and ridiculous. That final battle sequence as well is pretty damn awful. It is pretty awful. There is one scene in the battle which I do quite like, which actually was a reference to the film 300 with Zack Snyder. When Jed is freed by Octavius, he gives him a sword and they go around slashing people's feet. Because they're tiny, they're little tiny wax figures. They go around slashing people's feet and it's done in slow motion, which is to kind of homage 300, the movie that Zack Snyder made. I thought that was hilarious. That was the funniest scene in the film. I do think the CGI is a bit hit and miss this time. I think the CGI looks all right. They get away with it, but it doesn't look, for me, as good as the first one, and that says something. So, to me, this is a very bad sequel. It's a bit of a mess, but I do find some decent things in it. But I really don't like it, so I'm going to finish up by giving Night at the Museum 2, Battle of the Smithsonian. I'll probably give it a 4 out of 10. There we go, folks. That's my review of Night at the Museum 2, Battle of the Smithsonian. What do you think? Please comment down below and let me know. And stay tuned next time when we review the third and final film of this trilogy, Night at the Museum 3, Secret of the Tomb, released in 2014. So look at 5 years after this. Wow. Okay, so thank you very much. And until next time, see you soon. Bye for now.